This is the Pooja and Gurdeep podcast
from 98.1 CHFI Studios in Toronto, Canada.
Hey, Toronto, this is Ed Sheeran.
This is Kelly Clarkson.
Hi, this is Bryan Adams.
This is Adele.
This is Madonna.
It's Michael Bublé, and you're listening to the Pooja and Gurdeep show.
It's fun. They're amazing.
I have a fun exercise for you to try with your partner. It actually happened by accident with my husband, Paul. So he was away last week. He was in Europe, and okay. I was with the kids. My parents came to help.
Is that the exercise? Your partner leaves the country?
Yes. You pass. Yay. So he was gone. I was holding it down. I had a lot of help, and it was great. But he came back, and he wasn't feeling great. He was a little bit cranky.
Too much paella?
Maybe.
Okay.
Maybe. You know, I'm sure there was a lot of partying mm-hmm. while he was away as well. It was for my brother-in-law's 50th birthday.
So good times.
I'm sure he was tired. Yes, there was a lot going on. He was jet lagged.
It was a euphemism.
Yeah. And he was basically just not being very nice to me. So
what? That's not the Paul I know.
He was just being cranky. He was being cranky. And so I just said to him, like, so are, and I tried being really nice to him and then I still got nothing. And then I said, so are you ever going to say anything nice about me? And he's like, oh yeah, A, you're adorable. And then I'm giving him the look, and he's like, B, you're beautiful.
Okay.
And he's like, C, you're clever.
I was just going to say clean.
D, you're dedicated, right? Oh, and he's going for the whole alphabet.
Did he have 26 things lined up?
Well, then he got to E. And
you're excellent.
And you would think he would say
you're
something
exceptional.
Like that. No. He said, electable.
Electable?
Not
are you running
delectable.
For office?
Electable. And I said, I'm not running for office. And he's like, but if you were to, you would be elected.
It went off the rails.
Yes.
It went off the...
He only made it to E. And I thought, how fun would this be if you did this with your partner?
It's just the fifth letter.
Yes. Yes, like, put your partner on the spot and make them describe you.
This could be like the latest TikTok trend.
Yes, A to Z and see what happens.
You invented a trend that might go viral.
Maybe you'll get past E.
Okay, well, let's flip the script then. You do this for me.
Oh, no.
Yeah, go. Because you can't prepare for it. It's just got to be on the spot.
Okay.
Go.
Abbreviator.
That's good. I'll give you that. That's good.
Yeah, you abbreviate things. Yeah. B, bestie. Because you want to be my best friend.
All right, whatever,
C,
go.
C, childlike.
I'll give you that, sure.
D, dude.
No, you didn't even make it as far as your husband. That's terrible. Okay. Dude?
So it's harder than you think.
That's what?
My dude.
At least get thrown off at a weird letter like Q.
My dude.
From CHFI Studios,
it's the Pooja and Gurdeep Podcast.
Kids are back in school. They're back in class. They have to get back to learning and homework. So I'm going to give you some homework. I'm going to give you a math problem.
Whoa. I thought I left homework.
I know. It's only fair. It's only fair that the adults get in on it, too. This is one of those math problems that has the internet divided. So
okay, I like math.
I'm not sure we're going to get to the right answer because there's so many different answers on the internet.
Is this the math equivalent of the like black and gold and blue dress or whatever from like a decade ago?
Yes.
Like we can't decide what the answer is?
Well, you're our math guy. You're a resident math guy. So I figure if anybody can figure this out, it's you.
Okay.
So are you ready?
A lot of pressure, but sure.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
I know it's early, but here we go. Okay. You don't have to write anything down, but just listen to the statement.
Oh, I'm ready.
Statement.
I've got my abacus. Let's go.
Okay. I have six eggs.
Six eggs? Fried, scrambled?
Hold on.
Okay.
I broke two.
Broke. Two.
I fried two.
That's two. Delicious. Good choice.
I ate two.
You didn't fry the one? You didn't eat the ones that you fried?
How many eggs do I have left? I have six eggs.
Yeah,
I broke two. I fried two.
Okay.
I ate two.
Hold on a second. Because broke, broke could mean you broke the eggs to put them in the pan. You have to break eggs to cook them.
Mm.
So that doesn't necessarily mean you dropped them on the floor. That could mean you broke the eggs to put them in the pan to cook them.
And then you fried them. And then you ate two. So how many do you have left?
Or how many do you have in your belly?
How many do you have left?
How many do you have left? Okay, you broke two.
So you basically just said four.
No, hold on. I haven't given you an answer yet.
Oh, okay.
So I'm going to say you broke two, you then fried them, and you then ate them. Yes, four.
You're saying four. So four was the most popular guess.
Yes.
So they say after preparing and eating two of the six, the answer is four.
Yeah.
But somebody else said six. I know you say you broke two, you cooked two, and you ate two, but you didn't say that of the six, you broke two, cooked two, ate two. You already told us you have six, so I'm to assume that you had eight to begin with. That's what this one person said. No. Another person said...
No, that person's doing like a Quentin Tarantino film. You're not starting with the end.
Another person said, I have six eggs, not had. So the answer is six.
Sorry, what?
Because I said, I have six eggs, yeah. not had. So you the answer is still six.
Oh, but then that's, again, putting the cart before the horse. Because the question at the end is, how many eggs do you have left?
Yes.
How many eggs do you have left? Yeah, I believe it's four. Because the other scenario is, like, let's say you broke two and those, you're not counting those. You fried two and those are separate. You ate two and now those are gone. I could see why people would answer zero.
Nobody guessed zero.
Or two.
Yeah.
But I think the most logical answer is four, because I think this whole process is talking about the same two eggs. I think your other four eggs are still in the fridge in the carton. These two eggs are the same eggs in each of these three postulates.
Okay. What do you think? Text us right now at 981-981. I have six eggs. I broke two. I fried two. I ate two. How many eggs do I have left?
Gold and blue.
The Pooja and Gurdip podcast
from 98.1 CHFI.
Can we back it up to this math problem? Okay, so how many eggs do we have left? There are so many texts coming in right now, Pooja. What are people saying?
And so majority are saying four. There's a lot of sixes too. I would say maybe four and six are pretty even. I said two, and there's definitely a few who agree with me here. I got a couple saying I agree with you.
Give me the rationale.
So Michelle wrote in, says, I say two as well, Pooja. I agree. You broke two. Ate the two you fried. Six minus four equals two. That's how I see it. I'm a teacher. She's a teacher.
She's a teacher.
We
okay.
can't argue.
So she is. So it's all up to interpretation with this thing. So yes. Michelle, the teacher, is assuming that the two you broke are two that you, like, let's say, dropped on the floor. They're wasted, mm-hmm. and then you're cooking two other ones. Therefore, you have two left. I can sort of understand that. This person's saying six.
A lot of people saying six.
They're saying you have six left because you broke two, you fried two, you ate two. They're all in the past tense of the verb. But because you said at the beginning, you have six. But my problem with this isn't a Quentin Tarantino movie. You're not like going back. You're jumping timelines.
Okay. If you're just tuning in, you're like, what are you guys talking about? Why are you talking about four, six, two, zero? Some of the answers as well. This is the question. I have six eggs. I broke two. I fried two. I ate two. How many eggs do I have left?
I think it's four. Most people seem to think it's four because I think it's implied that you're breaking two and then, you know, because you got to break an egg to cook it, you're breaking two and then cooking them mm-hmm. and eating them. Therefore, you still have four left. But there's no consensus answer. I don't think there's meant to be. But my favorite text, we'll put a bow in it with this. This text says, poor chicken.
The Pooja and Gurdip podcast.
This is the Pooja and Gurdip podcast.
What is the worst gift you've ever given or received? And we're wondering this because, not sure if you saw this, Travis Kelce, purchased a horse for his girlfriend.
For Taylor Swift.
Yeah, and named it, I mean, I kind of like the name, Swift Delivery. It's a three-year-old horse, and this is a racehorse.
Wow.
Yeah.
Ooh, it's what every girl wants.
A racehorse. By the way, this horse is actually its first race. This is kind of cool. It's a local connection. It's going to be racing this Saturday at Woodbine Racetrack in Toronto. I'm just saying, maybe because Taylor's off for 2 months until her next show's in Toronto. She's done her European tour. Maybe she'll be at Woodbine.
Maybe she'll be there.
With Travis.
I mean, you
it's
would
the
think
first race.
If you're getting a gift, which
it's a gift
is
horse.
A racehorse with your name on it, you might want to see its first race.
Wait, is that what a gift horse is? When people say, like, never punch a gift horse in the mouth? I don't understand that saying, but is this a gift horse when someone gifts you a horse?
I'm not sure. We're going to have to ask Travis Kelce because he thought it was a good idea to get his girlfriend a horse. No, listen, horses are expensive. I get it. Like, it's a nice gesture. I know he was at the Kentucky Derby, so
yeah.
Maybe he's into horse racing and it's a passion of his. I don't know. There might be a backstory.
I mean, pretty flattering. Like, what if Paul bought you a horse and named it, like, Swifty Pooja Delivery? Amazing.
That's the tough part. When you get a gift that you don't like or understand, how are you supposed to say thank you? It's thank you with a question mark. It's thank you. It's one of those. I had an ex who actually got me a gift. It was for my birthday.
Uh-oh.
And it was from the Bombay Company. You remember the Bombay Company?
Oh, yeah. My mom had a bunch of stuff from there.
So I opened the box. It's a pretty big box. And I take it out. It's a wooden ship that looks like the Titanic. Okay.
Okay. It sounds kind of cool.
Yay. Wooden ship.
Like,
thank
not a ship
you.
In a bottle, like a giant wooden
like
ship.
Like a giant wooden ship. But it wasn't exactly the Titanic, but it kind of looked like a model Titanic. Anyway, I didn't really get it. And then over some time, I was just like, oh, so you got me a ship. Just wondering, like, why did you think I needed a ship? He's like, remember when we went to go watch Titanic, the movie? And like, I really loved it and you hated it. I was like, yeah. And he's like, so I got you the ship.
What? So this was based off Titanic, the movie, which you did not enjoy.
But he really liked it.
And he got you a giant ship that you put on display.
To remind him of the film he really loved that I didn't enjoy so much.
When you guys broke up, did you send that ship into the iceberg?
Yeah. I mean, both hit an iceberg, I think you could say. The relationship and the wooden ship.
Okay, see, I love the horse as a gift, but I think the Titanic ship that you got was a terrible gift. What is the worst gift you've ever given or received? That's what we're looking for. The worst gift you've ever given or received. Call us right now. 416-872-CHFI.
What is it?
It's a gun rack.
A gun rack. Yeah, right. I don't even own a gun, let alone many guns that would necessitate an entire rack. What am I gonna do with a gun rack?
You don't like it? Fine.
From CHFI Studios,
it's the Pooja and Gurdeep Podcast.
What is the worst gift you've ever given or received? We're asking you this because, I mean, I personally think this is a great gift. Travis Kelce got a horse for his girlfriend, Taylor Swift. It's named Swift Delivery. And Pooj, its first race is in Toronto at Woodbine this Saturday.
Yeah, and it's what every girl wants, you know? Oh, you bought me a horse. Thank you.
she's going to write a song about this.
Of course she is. And you know what? Horses are expensive. This is a great gift. It's a nice gesture. Maybe they're into horse racing. I don't know. Or maybe she gave him one of those like, oh, thank you.
You think so?
A horse named after me. You don't know. We don't know.
I mean, what do you get to the girl who has everything? Okay,
true.
So what is the worst gift you've ever given or received? Let's go to Wendy in Brampton.
My husband, we started dating, and he bought me an ant farm for Christmas.
Huh?
An ant farm?
Yes.
Is that one of those things that it comes in like glass?
Yeah, it was like a glass ant farm.
Okay.
And there was a little box, another gift. I'm like, I swear to God, if there's ants in this box, I'm going to freak out.
You can only get me one ant-related gift.
It was a necklace, a gold necklace with a diamond and a pearl. So
okay.
He
okay.
adjusted and fixed the problem with the ant farm.
Okay, it was like a 1-2 punch. You know, the first one, you're like, what?
First one lowers your expectations. The second one brings you back.
Yes.
Wendy, thanks for the call.
Okay, have a good day.
Colleen in Georgetown, what's the worst gift you've ever given or received?
I was given a toilet seat from my husband for Christmas one year.
Are you lying?
Just the seat, not even the whole toilet?
No, and it wasn't even a special seat. It was literally a replacement acrylic toilet seat. And my kids to this day never let them live it down. Remember when you bought mom a toilet seat? And I was like, oh, I remember when I got it. Yes, I wasn't impressed.
Okay, I think this might be the worst one of the day. Because at least if it was one of those fancy, like, tushy bidets, like the cool attachment. No, it's just a basic acrylic toilet seat.
A basic white acrylic toilet seat. And his reasoning was, well, ours was getting old and, it was starting to peel a little bit. So I thought you would like it. You're kidding me.
And also, I love you here.
Yes, exactly.
Colleen, thanks for sharing.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you so much. I love your show.
Love you too.
Thanks, Colleen.
All right, let's do one more here. The worst gift you've ever given or received. Jim from Scarborough.
I followed her list to a T. We always ask, what do you like? So she said, and I gave her exactly what she asked for. Nothing.
Oh, no.
She said she wanted nothing, and you listened. You know that's a ruse. It's not real.
It's a trap.
She's always said, this goes back to a previous conversation we had, do as I say. So I did as she said, and I still got trouble. I gave her nothing.
I think that's the worst gift ever. The nothing gift is the worst gift ever.
So when someone says, give me nothing, really it means what?
It means, read my mind. You should have been paying attention.
Okay. It's conversations.
Really?
Again, Jim, it's conversations like these that make me really glad I'm single.
You're my hero. I'm living vicariously through you.
I hope your wife's not listening. Jim, thanks for the call.
You're welcome. I appreciate it.
The Pooja and Gurdeep Podcast.
From 98.1 CHFI.
I mean, that song's just got to put you in a good mood. It's National Red Wine Day. Is it too early to celebrate?
It's probably a little too early, but you do you. I mean, it's up to you. Wine is an interesting thing. I love the taste of wine. Do I know anything about wine? Like, could I tell you what it is that I'm tasting? No. And the people who just know, either I'm very impressed or I think you're lying.
Yeah, it could be both. The power of suggestion is real. Like, a sommelier says something, I'm like, oh yeah, I do smell that.
Yeah, but I don't know. I don't, and I think if you just say like certain buzzwords when you're sipping wine, like, ooh, tannins or notes of, and then add bergamot in there.
Yes, you gotta drop a notes of in a tannins.
Yeah, or hints of.
Yes.
Yeah, or aromas.
Very suggestive.
Yeah, or whispers. Whispers of leather. I don't know.
Okay, you
and
know what?
Tobacco.
I've never been confident at a wine tasting, but I feel like you're inspiring me.
You think you could do it?
I'm going to give this a go with some of your suggestions.
Okay, this is like a fake it till you make it type of situation.
Absolutely. Okay. I need you got to set me up though here.
Okay, so you're at a party. Here we go. Okay, actually, no, sorry. Hold on. Sorry, can we cut that for a second?
It's too noisy.
Let's take you to a more sophisticated, upscale restaurant.
5 stars, Michelin, here we go. Ooh. Oh, yes. This wine's luscious viscosity is built off aromas of rich, dark chocolate almonds, the good kind that the kid fundraising for his baseball team sells you. Its aromatic notes lie somewhere between brand new textbook and gently used vehicle. It's understated yet stated. If you pretentiously swirl it around enough, it'll turn into actual fairy dust. It has hints of summer fling, spicy, short-lived, and deeply regrettable. The underside of your palate will detect overtures of spray-on sunscreen, SPF 60, gushing rainbow, and fresh tennis ball can being opened.
What?
Its acidity is best described as racy, robust, and more complex than filing your taxes. It's precocious, yet surprisingly cautious. It has tannins and stuff that linger longer than a Toronto traffic jam. A cheeky little number that pairs well with bad decisions, this vino will benefit from the tones and complexity of the vines it comes from, which are actually the vines from the original Mario Brothers that they used to get to the clouds. It's exotic yet basic, out of reach yet attainable, clothed yet naked. Drinking it will turn you into an actual god.
Oh my goodness. I
know wine.
No. You use things like viscosity and hints of a summer fling and precocious, but also cautious? What?
Check, please.
Thanks for listening to the Pooja and Gurdeep podcast.
Listen to Pooja and Gurdeep live weekday mornings from 5 to 9.
Only on 98.1 CHFI.
Toronto's perfect music mix.